I'm going to present the case of 50 years lady. She's a homemaker, married for 33 years, resident of Saharanpur, who presented to the OPD with chief complaint of lump in the right breast for past 3 months. She was apparently well 3 months back when she noticed a lump in her right breast, which was insidious in onset, rapidly progressive in size, and initially 2 into 1 centimeters, and now 6 into 5 centimeters in size. It was painless to begin with, but is now sated with pain after the biopsy was taken. There's no history of any nipple discharge. There's no history of constitutional symptoms or trauma or loss of appetite or significant weight loss. No history suggestive of distant metastasis is present. She is non-hypertensive and non-diabetic. Past history, there's no history of tuberculosis. There's no history of taking oral contraceptive pills or hormone replacement therapy. There's no history of chronic medical illness or surgery done in the past. No history of chemotherapy or radiations received in the past. There's no history of drug allergy. She is non-vegetarian with normal bowel bladder habits and normal sleep pattern with no history of any addictions. Coming to the menstrual history, she attained her menarche at the age of 14. She had regular cycles of 3 to 4 days duration, and she achieved menopause 10 years back. She has 10 children. All were delivered by normal vaginal delivery. The first child was born at the age of 17, and her last child was born at the age of 21 years. 21 years old, the last child is. And there's no history of any abortion or miscarriage. There's no history of breast cancer in the first degree relatives. No history of BRCA-related malignancy in the family, like pancreatic, prostate, colorectal, or ovarian malignancy. General physical examination, I examined...
The history first. One is the oral contraceptive pills. What is its connection with breast cancer?
Sir, earlier the oral contraceptive pills had high amount of estrogen, which was associated with breast cancer, but nowadays the amount is less. So
dose of estrogen is reduced. Anything
and
else?
Also, the age at which they take OCPs was
right.
Not related to the age.
So that's not the age when you get cancer. Okay.
Any history? What is the importance of history of abortion?
History of abortions means there is unopposed action of estrogen, which will lead to increased risk of having breast cancer.
Abortion is a risk factor, that's correct. Unopposed action of estrogen.
Yes, sir.
And sorry. Yeah, please, Maninda.
Yeah. You mentioned history of breastfeeding. Did I miss that?
No, I did not, but she did breastfeed all her children.
For how long? It's also important. What is the optimum period which is protective?
6 months.
Minimum 6 months?
Minimum 6 months, that is 12 months is more protective, and that is
now
cumulative.
Is 2 years is cumulative, something like that. So what, 6 months?
12 months
is
cumulative.
Six months is
it could be 6 months in each child, two children, or cumulative 12 months.
Cumulative 12 months, that's right. Dr. Ratna? Okay, madam.
What is the connection of tuberculosis? The history.
I took the history of tuberculosis because in India, tuberculosis is very common, and patients may present with the breast lump, which could come out to be tuberculosis, and the management is completely different.
Good. And the constitutional symptoms, when you're referring to tuberculosis only.
Yes, sir.
Considering the short time that you had for this slide, many, many things I won't ask, but no history of BRCA-related malignancy in family.
Yes,
what
sir.
Is the family?
This is a very good way to take a family history for all those who are taking breast cancer family history. No history of BRCA-related malignancies in the family, like pancreatic, prostate, colorectal, or ovarian. When you complete that statement, the examiner is completely satisfied that you covered up the family history seriously. I was mentioning in the previous one, no similar complaint in the family. Even he has put it down. Yes, Dr. Priya, you are asking something.
Regarding the relatives, what is the, like first degree, second degree relatives and age, what has that got to do with the hereditary breast cancers?
If it is in the first degree relative, the chances are more of getting breast cancer.
There are some numbers, right?
I don't know the percentage.
You read it, it's important, although you didn't have time, so you can prepare it.
The age of onset of the disease in the first degree relative.
Early age.
That's what they asked. You just came, actually. Early age or late age?
Early age.
How early is early? Whenever in doubt, 35. In breast, everything is 35. 35 to 40. And actually, younger age is more likely to be genetically the kind of cancer. Dr.
Supposing
Ratna.
A patient comes to you in the OPD and says that my mother had cancer breast at the age of 40 years, when should I get my mammogram done?
You can tell her that.
So it should be at least 10 years before that age, and you can always get an X-ray mammogram done even though the age is less than 35, and thereafter, if it doesn't reveal a positive finding, then you can go in for MR mammogram.
Can you proceed?
Thank you, ma'am.
Examination.
Coming to the general physical examination, I examined her in the sitting position under the broader light after taking an informed consent. She was conscious, alert, cooperative, and well-oriented to time, place, and person. Her performance status was 90 by Karnofsky's, and she was nutritionally preserved, slightly overweight on account of BMI of 25.2 kg per meter square. She was well hydrated, with pulse rate of 76 per minute in the right radial artery, which was regular in rhythm, normal in volume, and good character, with no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. Her blood pressure was 130 by 80 in the left arm in supine position, and respiratory rate was 14 per breaths per minute. It was regular. There was no pallor, sinusitis, clubbing, icterus, or pedal edema, and no generalized lymphadenopathy was present. Her systemic examination was normal. Examination of the breast. The left breast and axilla was normal. There was slight asymmetry with nipple areolar complex of the left breast slightly higher than the right and deviated outwards. On inspection, there were dilated veins over the right breast. There was visible fullness in the upper outer quadrant of the right breast. There was no nipple retraction or dimpling or puckering. The overlying skin appeared normal. There was 1 into 1 centimeter healed scar of biopsy taken in the past in the upper outer quadrant of the left breast. There was no redness, sinus fistula. There were no features suggestive of skin involvement, like ulceration, satellite nodules, or podhranch. On palpation, the loco-regional temperature was not traced. There was an ill-defined lump of around 7 into 5 centimeters in its greatest dimension and also perpendicular to it. It was palpable in the upper outer quadrant. It was tender, hardened consistency, and moved slightly within the breast tissue. It was not fixed to the overlying skin, and it was not fixed to the underlying structures. It was not fixed to the chest wall also. Examination of the right axilla, there was a single ipsilateral 1.5 into 1.5 centimeter lymph node palpable, which was firm in consistency, mobile, and belonged to the central group of lymph nodes. Examination of the abdomen was normal. Examination of thoracic spine was normal. I would like to do pervaginal examination and digital rectal examination in this patient, but I did not do. Summary. 50 years postmenopausal lady with lump in the right breast since 3 months, which was rapidly progressive in size with no history of any nipple discharge or nipple retraction. It was painless to begin with and later became painful. There is no history of distant metastasis, no history of any menstrual irregularity, abortion, miscarriages, or hormone replacement therapy in the past. On examination, there was a 7 into 5 centimeter hard lump in the upper quadrant of the upper outer quadrant of the right breast with no fixity to the skin, pectoralis major, or chest wall. There was axillary lymphadenopathy present, 1.5 into 1.5 centimeter, single ipsilateral mobile lymph node with firm consistency. My provisional diagnosis is a 50 years postmenopausal lady with carcinoma of the right breast, clinical stage T3N1M0.
I think she deserves a big round of applause. Very nicely done.
Thank you, sir.
What is generalized lymphadenopathy?
When two or more than two contiguous regions of lymph nodes
non-contiguous
regions
contiguous
of lymph nodes.
Would not be this.
Non-contiguous.
And you mentioned, although I did not ask in the history, HRT.
Yes, sir.
HRT is prone to be more of a factor, not rather than OCPs. Why did you want to do the PV and DRE in this case?
So to rule out any primary in the ovaries or rectum, and to also rule out a blummer shelf.
In the deposits.
Deposits.
Can she have Krukenberg's?
She is postmenopausal, so it's unlikely, not possible to have.
Correct. Dr. Priya, you can start from there.
You said that there was a scar in the breast. Was it over the lump or was it distant from the lump? And what is the importance?
It was distant from the lump. It was the scar of the biopsy which was taken. So the direction of the needle.
What is the importance of the scar in the breast? Location of the scar?
What was that scar of? It was
of the biopsy which was taken.
Would that be a part of the disease or skin or what you are going to
do? No.
It will be because if it is involved, then you don't do that.
Yes.
No, so if it is a very distant from the lump, the management changes.
That has to be included while performing the surgery.
So you have to say where it is located. And regarding...
Sukriti, you said it is ill-defined lump.
Yes, ma'am.
Are the cancer breasts ill-defined or well-defined hard lumps?
Ma'am, they're generally well-defined hard lumps, but in this case, there could be some desmoplastic reaction or inflammation which could lead make the lump irregular.
You said this was tender, later on,
yes,
painful.
Ma'am.
So that made this ill-defined.
Yes, okay. Ma'am.
Desmoplastic reaction is what? You said you use the right term, actually, desmoplastic reaction around it, and madam was asking the right question. Is it inflammatory or what is it? Some kind of, it's inflammation-like, but it's not inflammatory. Yes, Dr. Priya, I stopped you there. You were asking something. The scar is done. So, Dr. Ratna, you're fine with that?
Regarding scar, I'd like to ask another question. When there's a history of scar undergoing biopsy, did you inquire what was it for? Were they suspecting any cancerous lesion or what?
Timing of the scar, when was it done?
When was it done?
It was done around a month back. Only.
Recently only.
Yes.
Yeah. So, looking at the size of the lump, do you think looking at these CT, whatever did you say is this?
T3, N1, and M0.
So, what is it?
Any breast cancer?
The tumor, if it is in the outer quadrants, they are likely to get to have axillary.
Which is the most common site for breast cancer? Which quadrant?
Upper outer quadrant.
The maximum breast tissue is there. Okay. Now, if it is medial, which groups can be? Which lymph node groups could come into business?
Internal mammary.
And what would happen to the lateral ones?
The contralateral.
It can also go to the other side.
Yes.
And therefore they are different.
Most, even in medial tumors, inner quadrant tumors, most common site of metastasis nevertheless is?
Axilla.
Axilla, right?
Don't miss it. How do you proceed now? Can you proceed?
Yeah. I would like to do investigations to confirm the diagnosis, to support and stage the disease and to treat the patient. To confirm the diagnosis, I would like to go by triple assessment, that is clinical examination followed by radiological, since she is 50 years old, bilateral mammography, followed by incisional biopsy in the form of core biopsy.
Okay.
And then to support and stage the disease, I would like to do CCT thorax with upper inclusive of upper abdomen, ultrasound abdomen, and bone scan, basically to have a metastatic workup in this patient.
It is CT abdomen and pelvis now. So it is CT thorax, upper abdomen included, and
ultrasound
CT.
Abdomen.
Ultrasound and CT, they do CT now, bone scan. And then if the patient is symptomatic, we can go for the MRI brain. Otherwise, it's not routinely done. You did a clinical examination of the abdomen to rule out what you said, ovarian or other anything else you wanted to look for. What is the metastatic disease in the abdomen if it happens? You look for what? Ascites or organomegaly?
Ascites. Yes.
So what do you do? Core biopsy done. It is triple negative. I'm saying triple negative because that's the commonest.
How do you do a core?
No, we are just proceeding. You've done this, core biopsy is triple negative. It is grade 3 on histology. And you have the case, there is no metastasis. It is M0. And your staging is correct. How do you approach it? Is that what you are asking?
No, I'm asking, would you like to do something else along with the core biopsy? Some marker or something?
No, that is when we plan neoadjuvant chemotherapy. No, she has not yet decided. Are you planning neoadjuvant in this?
Yes, sir.
So what extra you would do?
We can do Ki-67 as a...
the marker. Anything you do to know where the tumor was?
When, where, how you take the core biopsy and what else do you add there and for what?
I'm not understanding.
What? Okay, like, I'll explain the question to you because that's come abruptly. Core biopsy, you're doing? How many passes?
Five,
okay. And the broad needle. You're doing it, core biopsy, you're doing it. And you're planning new adjuvant chemotherapy. Can you do something extra, more? That's what is asked. Not the marker status. We are putting the patient on new adjuvant chemotherapy. If there is response, what can happen? If the tumor disappears, how would you know where the tumor is?
We can put a clip.
You can put a clip there. That's what all clips. Shout. They're all trying to tell you. Putting in a clip. Anything else, Dr. Priya? We're done?
The best test, the highest specificity and sensitivity test for bone mets. Which test?
Bone scan.
No, ARP. More than bone scan. Pet.
Speak
what
loud
pet?
Into the mic and
pet.
Speak.
Pet what scan? Pet? It is not the not the FDG pet.
Isotope
which
is different. Which isotope you would use?
What isotope you use? Recommended by NCCN, it is sodium fluoride PET.
So it's now sodium fluoride PET, which is bone specific, because the other PET is not routinely recommended. It is done. When is the PET scan done for locally advanced breast cancer?
If there is a remnant or a recurrent disease.
Remnant or recurrent disease and. Is there anything to do with response evaluation? What criteria is used for response evaluation in neogen chemotherapy?
Racist criteria is used.
What is racist?
Response evaluation criteria in solid tumors.
Can you club that with PET scan?
Yes, PET racist can
that's
be done.
That's where it can also be
to
used.
Evaluate.
So how do you proceed now? You've done. I've given you the situation. They've asked you all questions. What do you do now? You're sitting in MDT. Surgeon alone doesn't take these decisions. So don't ever jump the gun. Don't go to the other side. What would we discuss in the MDT?
Regarding the immunohisto...
No, this is the case. There is no immunohistochemistry we are discussing. It is triple negative.
Triple negative.
I've already told you. Grade 3, size you know.
We'll plan for a new adjuvant chemotherapy in this patient, followed by 3 cycles, 3 weekly can be given, followed by a modified radical mastectomy, and then the adjuvant chemotherapy and radiotherapy.
Is there any problem if I can do the surgery up front?
We will not be able to get the advantage of in vivo chemosensitivity. The tumor can be downstaged by neoadjuvant chemotherapy, which will...
one thing I agree, that is getting the in vivo chemosensitivity. Otherwise, if you are able to get a clear margin, it is possible to do upfront. Does sequencing make a difference in outcome?
It does not.
So whether you give before or after, there is no advantage. But neoadjuvant chemotherapy provides you with the in vivo chemosensitivity.
And how many cycles would you like to give? And which drugs would you like to recommend?
1 minute, that she said. Now you're doing the neoadjuvant chemotherapy for one this reason. Any other reason? I told you it is triple negative. Now the dose and drug, etc. Now you said 3 weekly already. Which drugs and the dose?
CAF regime. Can be given.
It is triple negative.
Negative,
I have repeated.
Taxane based. Paclitaxel.
Okay.
Can you give an adriamycin based regime followed by taxane?
When an examiner is asking that question, please see the answer in it.
It can be given.
And can we give straight away 8 cycles of neoadjuvant prior to surgery? Or how many cycles would you like to give? 4 cycles?
She said 3
not
cycles
many,
surgery,
not
then 3
many
cycles. Can you give all 8 in the beginning?
No.
No, it's not no. It can be given.
But then the morbidity will be more and patient might
so
not...
So you should say that depending on the performance status. That's why you take the performance status. What performance status is the cutoff when you don't give chemotherapy?
60.
Anything?
Yeah, how do you assess the response?
By...
to neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
There's RECIST criteria. And
go ahead.
What is that then? What does it show? How much percentage reduction, etc.?
If it is 75 to 100%, it is a complete response. Less than 50 is no response, and 50 to 75 is partial response.
75 to 100 is a good response. I mean, you won't say complete response. Complete response is when clinically the tumor has disappeared, which is called CCR, clinical complete response. PCR is pathological complete response. And now the response is, as Dr. Priya was mentioning, 8th edition, the lymph nodes as well as the primary both have to disappear. And coming to the question that Dr. Athiya was asking, all cycles, less cycles, when do you decide that patient is not responding?
After 3 cycles also, if there is a...
It's after 2 cycles.
2 cycles.
The disease static or progressing, you change either to second line or you go for surgery. But surgery upfront can be offered, so don't say always new.
What is the tumor diameter? Suppose there are one single tumor and there are small satellite nodules. What do you take? You take a sum of all the nodules for the assessment or what?
I don't know.
Can you answer that? Please answer that question. Mm-hmm. Question you asked.
The latest agency says only the biggest tumor, the largest tumor size is considered. And according to RECIST criteria, just a small note, there are measurable and non-measurable. The measurable lesions, you can measure the response, and non-measurable lesions, you see the response with respect to disappearance of the lesions.
I would add
other
one
thing,
more point
Dr. Maninder,
yeah.
Dr. Maninder, regarding that only,
yeah.
For the benefit of all, multicentric versus multifocal. What is the difference?
If it is within 4 centimeters of the tumor, it is multifocal, And if it is outside,
so it's no longer the no. If it is multicentric, means earlier you used to call all quadrants.
All quadrants.
So quadrant is no longer taken. It's the 4 centimeter mark.
Yeah, I just wanted to add one more point that when you are assessing response, if it is increasing, then you take the smallest reference size, and if it is decreasing, you take the largest one.
And is there any role of MRI in assessing tumor response?
Let's move
MRI
to the,
would be more,
let's move to the treatment. Right? You need imaging. For ACS, there is single dimension, so MRI is required. MRI. How do you proceed now? The question was 3 versus 6 versus 8 cycles. It is you will always say, you'll discuss it with the medical oncologist. Response is the basis and performance status is the criteria. Patient has not responded and you're going in for treatment. What surgery would you offer?
Modified radical mastectomy.
What is modified radical mastectomy?
Removal of the breast tissue along with the nipple areola complex and axillary tail of Spence, along with pectoral fascia and level 1, 2, 3 axillary lymph nodes, while preserving axillary vein, thoracodorsal pedicle, medial and lateral pectoral nerve, and nerve to serratus anterior.
I think that's complete. We can't say anything. That's complete answer. So, and all of them, yes, and all of them would require adjuvant therapy of chemotherapy and
radiotherapy.
If this patient responded with the neoadjuvant, and if it is downgraded, size reduced, then what is the treatment?
We can offer breast conservation surgery in the patient.
Now, if you're going to offer, very good question, if you're going to offer breast conservation and if you're not left a clip there, you would not know where to go. That's what Dr. Priya was asking, so be alert to that. When that question is asked, you should always have an antenna up, okay, marker. And we leave a marker as a routine because we don't know whether the tumor was there or not later on. The footprints are gone. So now answer that question. You can offer breast conservation. What counseling? It's not a simple, straightforward job. What would you like to do before you offer breast conservation to this patient?
To rule out multicentricity.
What do you do?
MRI.
Okay, next.
And what also counseling? Counsel the patient for post-op radiotherapy.
No, beyond and that, what recurrence. Will you tell her? She'll ask you what is the risk.
The risk of recurrence and the remnant
is higher.
Is higher than the...
You have to. So what do you do on the table, therefore? It's mandatory, especially in these cases, not mandatory. When you're doing surgery, suppose you've done lumpectomy.
We leave the clips.
You do all the time. Mm. What do you do here specifically, where you want to see that you're sure that you've done
for
the
margins.
Resection R0? What do you do for the margins on the table?
Frozen section.
What is ink margin? What is inking of margin?
Yes. When you remove a tumor, what is inking? Say inked margin. What is that? What does the pathologist do to the tumor that you, the specimen that you give?
They stain it and they
see it. Ink. So that they get the margins all around. And that is what is inked margin.
And especially if you're going in for BCS, of course this is not a case meant for BCS, but nevertheless there's a controversy whether after neoadjuvant can we go ahead with BCS. If you're going in for BCS, an intraoperative ultrasound is much more helpful, reduces the recurrence rate, right? And re-excision rate. For that matter.
Thank you.
So, you're doing an MRM. What would be your limits of incision to prevent complications of radiotherapy later?
We would, the incision will be marked, will be made horizontally, and we will take care not to extend it into the axilla.
Okay. What is the limit there for laterally?
Anterior border of the
anterior
axilla.
Anterior, medially?
The lateral border of the sternum.
Good. Upper border? We don't. We go for the breast. So it's no longer clavicle and no longer inframammary fold. We want to wind up quickly. The breast conservation in locally advanced breast cancer is offered with counseling. That is high risk of recurrence. Patient has to be followed up.
Radiation
is going to be given to all. Cost basis may not be as good. So you have to brief the patient about it. If she's insisting on it, the patient that they have taken into consideration in trials are smaller sizes. So their tumors, so they give neoadjuvant chemotherapy to a lot of them so that the tumor becomes even smaller. And the decision is not based just on the tumor size, it's on tumor breast ratio. And if tumor breast ratio is good, we do that. Lumpectomy done, 3-dimensional clear margin. Ink margin being negative is taken. But here, post NACT, we take up to 2 centimeters. People take a wider margin. And they get a frozen section and cavity shave, which is optional. And it leaves clips, as you rightly said, at the tumor bed for subsequent radiation.
What are the other adjuvant treatments that you know of, like other than chemo and radio?
This is radiation. This is triple negative.
This is triple negative.
Yeah. If it is not triple negative, we can offer.
Even in triple negative, can you offer something else?
I'm not aware of.
There is a role of bisphosphonate in preventing metastasis to bone.
Finally, when we complete it, right, patient is prepared for radiation. And you've decided patient should get radiation. The people will ask you, what kind of radiation facilities have you seen? What kind of radiotherapy can be offered, which is best? Because this is left side or right side?
Right side.
Suppose it is left side, there is a chance of various morbidity. So what can we do?
Accelerated
partial beam can't work here.
We can
use the word which is common, somebody was prompting, conformal. Which should be just the dose to the tumor chest wall. What are the indications for radiation in patients with breast cancer?
If we have all the cases of breast conservation surgery, if less than 10 axillary lymph nodes are removed, if out of
less
10
than?
More than 4...
Less than 10, she said, yes.
If out of 10 more than 4 nodes come positive, and...
So there is a... I spoke in the morning that... Formula of 3, 4, 5. What is that? Morning, I said.
5 centimeters lump size, 4
nodes,
and
grade 3.
Grade 3.
That's what I said in the morning. These are the criteria.
And
if it was if it was ERPR positive, then Dr. Priya may ask that question.
What are the areas radiated in radiotherapy? The areas to which radiotherapy is given?
To the chest and to the axilla.
If you don't know, say no.
No.
Don't try to beat around. You have to cover all the levels.
Supraclavicular, the internal mammary, infraclavicular.
I'm asking you the last question, probably related to adjuvant therapy. I thought I'll change the... This is going to be asked. Hormone therapy in this patient. She's postmenopausal and she's ERPR positive. What is the hormone therapy of choice?
Aromatase inhibitors.
Why not tamoxifen?
Aromatase inhibitors, the source is the peripheral conversion and...
What is the toxicity of aromatase inhibitors?
Osteoporosis.
If she was premenopausal, what's the drug of choice?
Tamoxifen.
Side effects?
Ovarian carcinoma.
Endometrial
carcinoma.
And? Thromboembolic. And what does it do to bone?
It is good for...
It's bone friendly. But you should remember that. How long do we give tamoxifen for?
3 to 5, mm-hmm. 3 years.
Would you like to combine chemotherapy with hormonal therapy? Yes or no?
No.
Yeah, very true, very good. Why?
Because they act on different stages of cell cycle. Mm-hmm. The hormone therapy acts mainly on the differentiated cells, that is the well-differentiated cells, and the chemotherapy will act on the actively dividing cells, that is the end phase.
So if it is a luminal beacon type of cancer, there are two variants, right? In one it is, what is type 1 and what is type 2?
The luminal types?
Luminal B is subgrouped into two. In the first one, you get Ki-67 positive. In the second one, you get HER
negative.
Positive. So if it is HER positive, and
Herceptin.
Then what would you do? Would you give trastuzumab with chemo or not?
We will give trastuzumab.
With chemo, na? Very true. Good.
Now, the question was the duration. I am surprised. You can't say 3 years. Nobody gives 3 years. It's minimum
five
is 5 years. And now we're giving to now the switch therapy is different. My question was, how long do you give tamoxifen?
5 years.
5 years. Now it is 10 years after the ATOM trial. Now it is
and
10
regarding
years.
Follow-up? I think we follow-up. Okay, so may I tell you? Follow-up, initially for the first 3 years, every 3 to 4 months, then subsequently every 6 months for the next 2 years, and then of course annual. Right? That
what
is
do you
necessary.
Do in a follow-up? Since the question was, what investigation?
Again, we'll examine the patient clinically.
It's
for
clinical.
Clinical.
Therefore, contralateral breast, what is the incidence of malignancy? These questions
20.
Are asked when somebody has done well. Contralateral breast, incidence of malignancy?
20.
Is it higher or is it
same for general? No.
It's actually 1%.
1%.
It's almost same. But 1%. Don't try to make it higher than that. That is it.
If a person develops recurrence on tamoxifen, what sort of a tumor do you think expected to be, according to receptors?
ER negative.
Yeah, they'll be hormone receptor negative. And do you know what is called a pseudo-adjuvant therapy?
That is beyond the point. Any question from anyone? And if you have to reconstruct, 1%, one minute. If there is a reconstruction plan, because patient is insisting, we do immediate versus delayed, I'm telling you all. Immediate is not preferred for cosmesis, because radiation should be completed. Then they use two stages, expander and then reconstruction. But that's beyond this. I think that with that we wind up unless somebody has a question. Well, LABC is almost always there in the exam. And let's give her a big round of applause for the presentation.
Thank you, sir.